be expanded to $1 trillion. President Barack Obama has also issued a stark warning for Congress to approve the stimulus plan or face an economy that could spiral into catastrophe.
Good evening, everybody. Please be seated.
He won the White House on a campaign of hope, but in his first presidential news conference, President Obama warned of doom.
My administration inherited a deficit of over $1 trillion. But because we also inherited the most profound economic emergency since the Great Depression.
Talk to me. Talk to me. If you feel the need or when you need the feeling, talk to me.
Hello everyone, I'm Timothy Ghost, still here in Las Vegas. You are watching That's IT's CES Episode 2. I've been here for a few days now and I noticed a lot of companies are actually putting in money developing eco-friendlier products. But in these days of cost-cutting, I wonder, what could their motivation really be? I'm gonna go find out.
At the Consumer Electronics Show this year, major brands wore their environmental awareness programs right on their sleeves. They didn't just have products that are environmentally sound, they now have policies and philosophies in place to address the growing concerns IT products inflict on the greater environment. But why now, when bailout, cost-cutting, and layoffs are the buzzwords of the year?
We have been doing this for quite a while already. It's just that the impetus now is taking on a greater momentum because we understand and it's very important for us to conserve this planet that we live in.
They're asking for it directly. They're looking for it indirectly too, though. So when consumers go and buy products, it may not be the first thing on their mind when they walk into the store, but inevitably, as they inquire more about the features or what's happening with these products, the environmental issues start to rise. And that's all, a lot of it's around, of course, energy usage. How much energy is it using? Are there more efficient ways of having products that work in my life, that require less energy? It's a natural thing for consumers to believe in and to do. So it's a very important feature now, and a requirement, frankly, in the way we think of developing products.
Some buyers may have been asking for greener things, but I'm pretty sure not everyone is convinced that green is really worth the green buck you're paying for, especially since they're often thought to cost more. So what are companies like LG doing to convince?
The simple answer, of course, is because it's good for the earth, for our children and the environment, helping global warming. But the real answer also, product by product, person by person, you want to save energy. Save money, and it's just lower power bills. And you can see here, lower, the power has, you know, LCDs are lower than the traditional CRT in our displays, but we're working on electronics and other ways of making LCDs even lower power going forward.
But how do you convince us to buy an LCD screen that will actually help us save power? Isn't it gonna cost more for us?
Can't, the market won't let it. So it's our job to provide more value year after year at ever better prices. And that's what we're working hard to do.
It does this by doing three things. First, the latest technology allows for less components. Less components equal less electricity. Second and thirdly, better components and smarter electronics have given way to the invention of regional dimming. Screens can now adjust their brightness according to the ambient light. Less brightness, less electricity. And the readings are proof. For a world consuming an average of 15 terawatts or 1 trillion watts of energy, think of it being able to power up 150 billion household light bulbs all at the same time. These energy savings provide some relief.
Think in the trade-offs it would have to, but in fact, by doing things like regional dimming, which gives you lower power, you actually enhance black levels and thus contrast and less picture quality.
First, it was the plasma. Then it was the LCD TV, and now it's the next generation television, the LED TV, or the light-emitting diode television. At this year's CES, most companies showcased their latest offerings, LED TVs that promise to reduce backlight levels, which will be more energy efficient and eco-friendly.
even in a TV product, we like to, you know, use new technology for the echo. For example, LED TV. We could, with LED TV, has, you know, mercury-free product and lead-free product. You know, we are not using any painting. So it is, you know, good for the earth. And also, we can reduce power consumption by 40% by using LED technology.
Another major component of being environmentally friendly is not just the product itself, but how it is made, shipped, and packaged.
It's continuing effort to be environmentally friendly. HP has come up with a very innovative way of packaging your notebook before delivery to the stores. They are now placed inside a laptop bag. So your laptop goes in, all the wiring goes in. It's packed in a box and shipped to the store. So what you get is a stylish laptop bag with your notebook.
And now that the technology and the know-how are available, IT engineers should really be looking into more ways to help us save on our power bills, save manufacturers' costs, and save the Earth's environment.
So exciting to see that they're finally taking care of the environment, and yeah, people will probably start buying into that as well. I mean, why spend money on an LCD screen that consumes 200 watts of power and you can buy one that consumes 60, which is the same as a normal light bulb?
The long-awaited trial for former Khmer Rouge leader begins in Cambodia, with survivors finally getting their first chance to see Doig face justice. Details on Primetime News.
It's a new highway that promises to ease Mumbai's traffic woes.
It's like doing a bypass surgery through the city of Mumbai.
Moving people was something the Khmer Empire excelled at, a lesson that resounds even up till today. Ingenuity, Wednesday, 8:30 p.m., exclusively on Channel News Asia.
Where do you want me to go? Until then, good night and good luck.
Where are my shoes? Tell me now.
Every Sunday at 10 p.m. on Okta's Oscar Specials on Film Art.
At one of the roadblocks, pro-autonomy
militia. We've waited so long for this day.
Experts announced what they hope is a reason
for assassination was attempted on the president.
The scene here serves as a reminder of nature's destructive power,
which has totally collapsed. I was told there are several hundred bodies buried.
Welcome back. That's IT is at the 2009 Consumer Electronics Show, and I'm under the LG Sky Charger tent, which is?
Well, it's part of LG's eco-mobilization program, which is our environmental responsibility initiative. What we're doing is charging phones out here on wind and solar power. Okay. So if you wanted to go ahead and charge your phone.
Okay, let's...
It's on this side. Pull that out. You just plug it in, put it in the box, and the blinking green light will go from green to red to indicate that it's charging. Give you your keys, go enjoy the show. You come back in an hour, your phone's charged off renewable energy.
All right.
Looking like a spaceship that just landed in the Las Vegas desert, this charging station utilizes both wind and solar energy to charge mobile phones of all brands. Definitely a welcome sight for those caught with a dead cell phone battery. And if you thought you couldn't get any greener than that, check out the first carbon-free phone by Motorola. Its housing is made from recycled plastic bottles, and all the materials in the box are printed on 100% post-consumer recycled paper. Its specs don't take a beating either. The phone doubles up as an MP3 player and has a talk time of 9 hours, meaning even less time needed to charge it. From a plastic phone to a paper laptop. To be specific, it's a laptop decked out in recycled paper or old egg boxes. It's Asus's latest commitment in melding the environment with eco-friendly technology. And if you're a nature aficionado, this bamboo laptop might just invoke a sense of calm in its user. Its shell and even the touchpad is made using bamboo instead of the usual plastic.
Fifty major consumer electronic makers submitted their most environmentally friendly products to Greenpeace for some sort of eco-assessment. Environmentalists have been asking for more greener products, but the question is, are manufacturers rising up to the challenge?
This is a common sight in many developing countries in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. E-waste, or electronic waste. Greenpeace released its findings at this year's CES, and according to the environmental group, there will be a significant reduction in e-waste. Because in place of these harmful PVC plastics that releases toxic chemicals when burned, manufacturers are increasingly using more recyclable materials in our gadgets. Greenpeace rated consumer electronic producers on eco-friendliness, and at the top of that chart are Samsung, Toshiba, Sony Ericsson, and Nokia. Nokia scored the highest for its comprehensive voluntary take-back program. Greenpeace says that truly green products need to be more energy efficient, durable, and free of toxic chemicals. Good progress has been made, but it feels that more is needed.
Well, there's a recession, so surprisingly, a lot of them are refocusing on the environment. Greenpeace was here to release a survey from 15 brands, I believe, of the top environmentally friendly companies and the lowest ones. It's interesting also to walk around. I didn't see this last year nor the year before that, or the year before that, but this time around, a lot of the major brands had a corner dedicated to their environmental philosophy. You can see the products that they've developed to save Mother Earth, and I think it's a trend now.
Companies are responding positively, but it's too slow. There needs to be more change and faster. We don't have any time. The amount of e-waste that's piling up in countries like China, India, Philippines, Africa, and Latin America are growing and growing. So this is an e-waste crisis that doesn't have time to slowly change. We need massive change, and we need massive change now.
We, the consumers of the world, are quite a demanding bunch. We used to come here to the CES just for cutting-edge technology. Now we want it cutting-edge. We want it slim. We want them easy to use and eco-friendly. But I guess that's what innovation is really all about. At the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas, I'm Timothy Goh. That's it.
If you feel the need or when you need the feeling, talk to me.
The long-awaited trial for former Khmer Rouge leader begins in Cambodia, with survivors finally getting their first chance to see Doig face justice. Details on Primetime News.
It is the idea of charity to do good when times are bad. What role should philanthropy play in these challenging times, and who should lead the way? Join us on Inside as we explore the ethos of giving in Asia, Thursday, 8:30 p.m. on Channel News Asia.
Of Pesta Perdana, live Friday, 27th February, 8:30 p.m. only on Surya.
Saturday on Japan Hour. The journey along the rivers of Japan continues. dubbed the most nutritious fish, savor freshly caught wild eel from the Kitakami River. Then kayak down the Tama River for a breathtaking experience, before embarking on a challenging climb to discover its source. Appreciate the beauty of rivers on Japan Hour, Saturday at 7:30 p.m. Japan Hour is brought to you by Sumitomo Corporation, ANA, All Nippon Airways, Calbee, Daikin, Funko, NEC, Pilot Pin, UOB Travel, and Yakult.
Nine-year-old Ding Wen is no longer camera shy these days. He was discovered 3 weeks ago as the world's youngest iPhone developer, and since then, he's been featured by countless international media. So when That's IT visited, the whiz kid knew exactly what to do. He was all geared up for a product demo. His application, Doodle Kids, a full-screen painting program on the iPhone designed just for kids.
You paint with one finger in Doodle Kids and comes out in different colors, shapes, and sizes. You shake your iPhone to clear the image. And you tie two fingers or more to get different gradient color effects for the background.
Written originally on the Apple IIgs computer, which was first released in the 80s, Ding Wen rewrote the application in JavaScript and Objective-C so that it could be ported to the iPhone. With the help of his dad, Doodle Kids was sent to Apple for approval. And before he knew it, Apple recorded more than 150,000 downloads worldwide. Ding Wen, who started learning programming at 7, understands 6 programming languages and has completed 20 projects. And he is also an action script programmer. And today, he is working on a more challenging project.
I'm planning to do a space game called Invader Wars. You can move the ship by touching the left side of the screen, and you can fire by touching the right side of the screen. You must fire the aliens while they try to attack you. It's actually not quite finished yet.
Invader War is currently on development as an iPhone application and will be available for download via App Store when it is completed. All right, in other news, engineers at Google have developed a software tool called Google Power Meter, which shows you your home energy usage in almost real time, right on our computer. A Power Meter widget added to the iGoogle homepage will receive information from utility meters and energy management devices in the home and show spikes in energy use over the day. Google cited studies showing that access to home energy information typically helps save between 5% and 15% on monthly electricity bills. The software is being tested with Google employees and not yet available to the public. It is the latest trend on Facebook right now. Writing 25 random facts about yourself and tagging 25 of your friends so that they do the same. And this random fad has actually helped drive up the growth of the social networking site. According to Compete.com, 4 times more visitors access Facebook notes in January. More Facebook news now, and it is looking to tie up with phone makers such as Nokia, BlackBerry, and Apple to offer more services. So what does that mean? Well, your friend's Facebook profile picture could appear whenever he calls. Facebook is currently worth $3.7 billion, but with all these tie-ups in the works, it could go up in the future. This is Sanjay Chedda. He is the head honcho of Microsoft's consumer and online division in Asia. He is the first to appear in this brand new segment where the head honcho of a company will tell us about a gadget or a software that he can't live without. And Sanjay's pick, no surprise, Microsoft's Internet Explorer 8.
It's the most safe, most secure, most robust and fastest way to access the power of the Internet. I wouldn't want to live without the Internet or without Internet Explorer 8. I'm using it every day in my life. I use the Internet a lot for my job, but also for my personal life, to consume information, to manage my finances, to shop online. This is a technology when you're on a web page and you want to look up the definition of some word that you see on a web page that you're not familiar with. It's very easy. It's one click away to go and look at information from another website while you're still on that main web page. Or if you want to be able to do some shopping or check another site while you're on one site, we make that very easy to do through IE8 accelerators. Another feature is a new thing called web slices. And web slices give you a slice of information from the Internet that's constantly updated that you can store in your favorites bar. And so say you're shopping for something on eBay and you find an auction on a particular item that you're interested in, you can create a web slice out of that. And then every time that auction status updates, if there's a new bid on that item, it'll show up in bold on your favorites bar. So you don't have to go manually check that site over and over again. It's very easy to know when the information has changed on that particular website.
This latest version of the Internet Explorer 8 was launched in January this year. And while it is Sanjay's pick, there is still more he hopes IE8 can do for him.
Perhaps another thing, anything the browser and the Internet can do to make my life simpler, you know, do my personal finances for me, answer my email for me, that'd be wonderful also. Maybe that's in the future.
You are watching That's IT's Gadget War. This is the first edition of Gadget War where we put two similar products against each other to see which one is best, or rather, which one works best for you. This week, I have the HTC Dream, a new Google mobile phone, and the HTC Touch Pro, which runs on a Windows Mobile 6.1 platform. So let's see which one is best.
Both phones start off on an even footing with touch screens. I like the responsiveness of the Dream's capacitive touch screen. It is easy to add applications to the home screen, move them around, and delete them from the desktop. The trackball makes it more convenient to scroll through long lists as well. On the other hand, the Touch Pro uses the Touch Flow 3D interface. This means that I can use my fingers or a stylus to navigate around the main menu. The main difference between the phones is the operating system. The HTC Dream is equipped with the Android operating system. It is fast, it's fun, and it's quite easy to use. You can sync your Google contacts, calendar, and email to your phone. But the best part is the Android market. It is here that you can download applications into your phone. And, at least for now, they're all for free. So I think the Dream has thrown in the first punch. And now on to looks. The Dream juts out at the bottom, bringing the phone speaker closer to your mouth. I only found that it got in the way when I was typing, which is a slight annoyance. What bugs me more is that the Dream only allows you to type using the keypad. Unlike the Touch Pro, of course, which comes with handwriting recognition and an on-screen keyboard. So I'm afraid that this round goes to the Touch Pro. The Dream is touted as an internet phone, and it shows. Web pages load pretty quickly on the supplied WebKit browser. You can pan and zoom on certain areas easily. Another winning feature of the Dream is the Google Map Street View. It's almost as if I'm in the East Village in New York. So it's 2-1 to the Dream. The Touch Pro's higher resolution means that videos appear sharper, although its screen size is less generous than the Dream. Both the Dream and the Touch Pro possesses 3.2 megapixel cameras, but the Touch Pro trumps with its LED flash and video recording function. So what's the final score?
Now it's time to pick a winner. And as you know, I'm not a big touchscreen fan, but I do have to pick a winner here. It really depends on your lifestyle choices. If you're more of an internet surfer on the go, then I'd suggest you go for the HTC Dream because, well, it's designed just for that and more. If you're more of a business user, you need your emails and your calendars and all that within a click, then I'd suggest you use the Touch Pro. As if the name suggests, Pro is for the professional in you. That's Gadget of the Week this week on That's IT.
I like all things great and small, but when it comes to IT, it feels like small is the next big thing.
But what happens as gadgets get small, smaller, and even smaller?
From a technological perspective, there are a few sacrifices that has to be made in order to fit into such a small form factor. So yes, size does matter.
And find out which of your favorite gadgets have gone mini-me.
On That's IT, Tuesday at 8:30.
This March, we pay homage to all people and things Asian. Meet one of China's living treasures, a 90-year-old artist whose merging of Western and Chinese painting techniques becomes his greatest achievement, painting a Titan. Be inspired by the success stories of outstanding Asian companies who have successfully built strong brand equity in their respective industries. Asian Brand Biography. Uncover the different facades of Asia through a special series of thought-provoking and enlightening Asian documentaries on our Documentary of the Week. Here's a simple man with an easy smile, but this Singaporean is anything but common. Find out how this globally acclaimed multicultural master found his literary and artistic voice to paint a smile. Get to know the region better this March on Channel News Asia.
My name is Wayne Wang. Whenever I'm in Asia, I love watching Channel News Asia. And happy 10th anniversary.
Channel News Asia, celebrating 10 years of Asian perspectives.
Hello, I'm Gerard Lum. You're watching Primetime News on Channel News Asia. The headlines. The U.S. Secretary of State calls for coordinated action to fight the global economic crisis as she wraps up her visit to Japan.
I am not ashamed of my sexuality as a woman and as a single person. I have broken no law.
Malaysian...
Talk to me.